If there's anybody who has to catch a plane or anything, why, just raise your hand and we'll call on you first and excuse you earlier. All right, we'll proceed, my left, your right to left, if there's no objection. And first, we'll call on Ms. Deborah Stabile, Assistant Commissioner of the New York City Department of Sanitation. And we do have your written testimony, which we appreciate. It'll be entered into the record. And you may proceed in any way you see fit and try to keep it to around 5 minutes.
I want to thank you for inviting the department to testify today. Commissioner Sexton sends his regrets for not being able to attend. We're in the middle of budget and fiscal negotiations with the rest of the city.
He was here a few months ago,
right.
So refreshing to have you here.
Okay, thank you. Since Commissioner Sexton last appeared before this committee, New York City has made significant progress towards meeting the challenges contained in the city's mandatory recycling bill that was passed last April. It became effective this past July, and under this ambitious law, we're expected within 5 years to divert more than 7,000 tons per day for recycling. This is on top of the already estimated diversion of 15% from the commercial sector that's already going on and the bottle bill. And that will put us at an overall diversion rate by 1994 of 40%. This puts us 3 years ahead of the New York State goal of, in 1997, of 40%. The mandatory law contains a comprehensive recycling program primarily developed and run by the Department of Sanitation. By the end of this fiscal year, the city will have committed more than $60 million in capital funds, more than $70 million in expense funds, and will have added more than 900 positions to the department for recycling. These include both people to go out and collect the recyclables as well as staff to do planning and promotion. Our primary residential program is our curbside and containerized apartment house recycling program. These programs are being phased in over the next three years and currently serve more than 1 million households. We currently divert from these households more than 250 tons per day. We expect this to grow to more than 2,300 tons per day by 1996. New York City faces unusual challenges in that two-thirds of our housing stock is multi-unit dwellings. We have, in order to address this, developed in part residential regulations that detail for all the households the kinds of materials they're required to separate, as well as how they must put them out for collection. We have currently designated glass, metal, and plastic containers, as well as newspaper, magazines, and corrugated cardboard. All of these materials are being phased in over the next few years. Under the regulations, paper materials will have to be separated from the regular trash, bundled, and tied for collection. And glass, metal, and plastic containers need to be rinsed and then placed in a recycling container that the department provides. To get people started, building owners are required to designate an area for the residents to put recyclables in that is easily accessible so that it encourages participation by all residents and makes it as easy as possible. Owners are also required to post signs in their buildings and distribute informational literature to their residents, notifying them of the recycling requirements. The city has spent considerable effort working with building managers to provide those materials, write letters for them, and to date has provided most of the educational material for the house, for the buildings. Okay. Because the department is aware that education and outreach are essential to the success of the residential program, extensive public education activities have been undertaken. In addition to providing informational materials to building owners for their residents, The department is issuing a recycling how-to handbook for building superintendents, organizing special events, making presentations at community meetings, advertising in local newspapers, and conducting educational programs in schools. The city currently spends $2 million per year on outreach material. This is in conjunction with more than 35 full-time staff dedicated just to outreach and education. This does not include the more than $15 million the department ultimately expects to spend on the purchase and distribution of containers for the metal, black, glass, and plastic containers. We have found that when we have gone and distributed these to homeowners, it has a dramatic effect on people's participation. We have found that our newspaper, which is not part of that does not go into the containers, that participation level increased as well as the participation for the metal, glass, and plastic. The department is also developing enforcement strategies to ensure compliance. Summonses are a big part of the mandatory bill. People will be fined if they do not participate. But the emphasis is on education. Under department policy, we will have a 6-month grace period for homeowners to get familiar with the program, what they're expected to participate with, and how they're expected to participate. During that 6-month grace period, we will be providing warnings to them. In addition to these residential programs, the department also operates and supports several others. Examples include mobile drop-off sites, which service currently 21 neighborhoods and 2 buyback centers. At the buyback centers, residents can bring their recyclable materials and receive immediate cash payment for their value. In addition, we hope that the buyback centers provide us information about hard-to-target materials right now, and that they can provide some state-of-the-art knowledge on materials and marketing and processing needs before we commit large full-scale programs to them. The law requires that we establish 5 buyback centers, one in each of the 5 boroughs of New York. Last year, this program recycled 600 tons of wood chips and we introduced a Christmas tree program also, and last year it recycled more than 600 tons of wood chips from over 70,000 trees. The wood chips were given away free. Hospitals, universities, horticultural institutions, and individual citizens were among those who did receive these wood chips. We also ran a pilot composting program this past fall, which proved very successful. We moved to a full-scale composting program in the fall of this coming year for leaf waste, and over the next 3 years we'll be phasing in a full-scale leaf and yard waste program that will run 8 months of the year. It will only be running in 33 of the 59 community boards of the city because not all parts of New York have many trees and grass and lawn. Ultimately, we expect that this program will divert 50 tons per day of material. Although these residential recycling programs have been moving fairly well, other programs that we have started are not moving as well. We've established a bulk program that has been operating for nearly 10 months. This bulk program has 3 parts to it. A curbside bulk program where you put out your washing machines, your furniture, and we send trucks down to pick it up. We have a self-help program where you can bring your materials to designated sites, and we then take that material for processing. And we also divert bulk that we collect from our lot cleaning efforts and bring it to vendors. We have found that these programs have not delivered the recycling tonnage that we originally projected. We found that this has happened for 3 essential reasons. One is that there's less tonnage there than we originally thought available. 2, the composition of the materials at the sites is not what we originally believed. And 3, the vendor's performance, those who we expected to pull out the recyclables from the bulk materials, has not been at meeting the levels of expectation that we originally planned. We are working in many ways to improve this situation, as well as expanding the targets of people that will participate. The Board of Education, Housing Authority, and others are targeted to help improve this. In addition, we're exploring other materials besides wood and metal, which were the original materials planned for recycling to pull out from the waste stream. We're looking and investigating whether tires and corrugated cardboard could effectively be pulled out and recycled. New York City's residential recycling program is now the largest municipally run program in the nation. To help learn more about recycling, we've been working with various government agencies and representatives from several environmental and consulting groups on establishing a variety of pilot programs aimed at identifying additional recyclable materials in the residential waste stream and finding out how to achieve the highest level of recycling in the most cost-effective manner. Towards this end, we're planning on establishing 5 demonstration intensive recycling zones. In each of these zones, we hope to learn more about participation, the collection, the processing, and the marketing efforts that need to be committed to making recycling work at its highest level. Separate from this, but which will support this, is that the city is also running the nation's largest waste composition study. We are examining 45 components of the waste stream. We're looking at the institutional, the residential waste stream, and are currently developing plans to examine as much as possible the commercial waste stream. New Yorkers will be recycling in their offices as well as their homes. As required by the mandatory law, the department is in the process of promulgating regulations covering commercial waste. Under the recycling law, the department must designate materials for recycling which constitute in the aggregate at least one half of the commercial waste stream. And the department is also issuing regulations for city agencies and institutions, not-for-profit institutions. We all understand that garbage is not truly recycled unless there are markets for the materials. From July of 85 to October of 89, the department has directly and indirectly ensured that more than 160,000 tons of material have been recycled back into the manufacturing or reuse sectors. Currently, the city is actively engaged in a variety of activities to support the development of markets for recycled products, for recycled materials, including market research studies on paper, metal, compost, cellulose, plastics, rubber, and stone aggregate. However, as recycling programs and the amount of material they collect grow, local efforts cannot ensure continued markets. National incentives must be established to make it more cost-effective for industry to incorporate post-consumer materials into its manufacturing process. The federal government must recognize itself as a purchaser with clout. The federal government's procurement actions have profound and immediate impacts on industry because of the size and scope of their needs. Entire industries demanding recyclables as part of their production needs can be created quickly by government action. In New York City, our major purchasing office is reviewing specifications.
Mr. Beal, in deference to the other witnesses, I think we have your statement,
okay.
And I think you've covered
the
major part of it. We
okay.
Thank you very much, and we'll come back to you in just a few moments. Thank you very much. Mr. Commoner, we appreciate your attendance here today. You have submitted some data, I believe, relevant to urban recycling. And I might ask one question as you discuss your discussion. You have one page here, comparison of two scenarios for disposing of 4,617 tons per day of residential trash. I suppose you'll tell us why you selected that figure, 4,610.
I will. Yes.
Proceed. And this, the document submitted will be received without objection. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Given the short notice, I didn't have time to prepare written material, but I'll do my best to explain what I have to say verbally. I direct the Center for the Biology of Natural Systems at Queens College. For the last 8 years, we have been doing intensive research on the entire trash problem. We are engaged by the City Council of Buffalo to study their problem, and we have recently been engaged by the Borough of Bronx to work on the problem in New York City. I want to begin by some very simple, basic points. Recycling, in my opinion, is the only way in which we can successfully dispose of urban trash. I think that any other method is going to lead to trouble and huge costs. Unfortunately, I don't think that fact has been appreciated as yet. And recycling is still looked on as something that's nice to do. It's a good thing, and if we do a little bit of it, maybe 25%, that's okay. I think that I will be able to show you that the potential for recycling is to take care at the present time of perhaps 85% of the trash stream. Obviously, that hasn't been achieved in the programs that you've heard about. And I want to discuss how we can get to that potential. The first point to make is that if you examine the waste stream, of course it varies from place to place, between 85 to 90% of the components are capable of being recycled by existing methods, by existing commercial methods. That means that a recycling program has that as its physical target. Now, in order to get there, there are several things you have to do. One is you have to decide that you're going after all the recyclables. To my knowledge, that is not done in any city recycling program at present. For example, in New York City, approximately 25% of the recyclables are even targeted for recycling. Obviously, you're not going to get very far by having that limited target. The other factor, of course, is participation rate. You've already heard that with good educational programs, the participation rate can get very high. In some towns, it's up to 90 to 95%. Finally, there's the question of how efficiently separation can be done at the household. And there, we have done a study to determine the maximum physical. We have done a study to determine the maximum physical efficiency of household separation and processing of all of the recyclable trash. This was a study we did under the sponsorship of New York State in the town of East Hampton. We had 100 volunteer families working for 10 weeks, separating all of their recyclables. They used four containers. One took the food garbage, which is recyclable. The second took paper, the third took cans and bottles, the fourth took the non-recyclables. When that was processed, we weighed everything, measured all the input and what came out. What we discovered was that 84.4% of the material collected from the households was actually recycled in marketable form. That tells us that this process can reach the maximum. Now, what we need to ask is, why aren't we able to get close to that figure so far? I've mentioned one reason. One reason is that the recycling programs so far have not targeted all of the recyclables. The main recyclable that's missing from every urban program that I know of is food garbage. Why can that be recycled? Because food comes from the soil, and it can be returned to the soil by composting it. When you hear of composting in urban recycling programs, all they're talking about is yard waste. At East Hampton, in our study, we composted yard waste together with the food garbage, and there are very well-developed commercial methods for doing this, so that one of the important things that's lacking in all of the urban programs is the inclusion of food garbage, which can be composted together with yard waste. Now, That's one major deterrent. Another major deterrent is misunderstanding about the economics of trash disposal. You hear over and over again people say, well, we can't afford to recycle newspapers because right now in Long Island, for example, a broker wants $20 a ton to take it. What people forget is trash disposal costs money. It's going to cost money. And in fact, recycling is so economic compared to the alternative, which is incineration. We found in East Hampton that it's 35% cheaper. It's so much cheaper that you can afford to give away all of the recovered materials and it will still be cheaper. For example, I think the cost of putting a ton of trash in the New York landfill is about $70 now. Well, you can afford to pay $20 to get rid of a ton of newspaper because that saves you $70. So there's a lot of misunderstanding about the financial side of it. There's also a good deal of misunderstanding about the market problem. The market problem is not simply one of the operation of the free market. Let me explain why we have so much trouble getting rid of newspapers now. The reason is that the structure of the paper industry, the newsprint industry, is such that there's been recently a great deal of investment in plants that use virgin pulp. You might ask, why does the New York Times use only 5% recycled newsprint, whereas the LA Times is well over 80%? Well, the reason is the New York Times owns virgin timber and virgin pulp industry. And so it's more economic for them to work that way. I think it'd be very important for an analysis to be made of how industry has to be reorganized in order to receive recycled materials. For example, we need to find out what are the bottlenecks in newsprint recycling. Are they de-inking? And this has to be done in advance because there are big investments and the investors need to know where material is coming from and that it's coming in a guaranteed and high quality form. Finally, I have to say that the greatest barrier to recycling is the trash burning incinerator. It is a fact that 80% of the trash can either be burned or recycled. And the moment you build a trash burning incinerator, you have blocked that much recycling. The situation in the state of New Jersey makes this very plain. New Jersey began an intensive program to convince communities to build incinerators. Warren County built the first one. By the time it was built, the state had passed the law requiring 25% recycling. Well, what happened was very simple. When the incinerator began to operate and 25% of the material was taken out for recycling, it didn't have enough BTUs in its fuel, and it couldn't sell enough electricity to break even, and the operation began to lose money. In other words, there is a competition between incineration and recycling. More than that, an investment in an incinerator, the first one being proposed in New York is over $500 million, is a huge capital investment. Once you make it, you want to use it, and it lasts a long time, 20 to 30 years. So the moment you build an incinerator, you have put a barrier against intensive recycling, that is, recycling targeted on all the material. And I might add, Mr. Slattery raised the question, I believe you did too, about why the cities weren't more interested in recycling and so on. Well, I have to tell you that the U.S. Conference of Mayors has a subsidiary which sponsors and does propaganda for incineration. And I think until the cities begin to understand that incineration is a block to recycling, we're going to be using recycling as simply a piddling adjunct to trash disposal. I have to say, in New York City, the approach is, as it is in most other cities, minimal. It targets only 25% of the recyclable materials. And the irony is that if New York City simply changed the instructions to the householder, the amount of material recycled could be increased enormously. In the neighborhood in which I live, we are required to put out 3 batches of material: cans and bottles, newspapers, and then a 3rd container with the rest of the trash. Well, that's an obligation on us to separate 3 ways. Now, if the city would simply change its instructions and still retain this same 3-way separation, you could target not 25%, but 100% of the recyclable material. Very simply, if the instructions were, use 1 container for food garbage, a 2nd container for paper, cans, and bottles, and a 3rd for all the non-recyclables, the city could then be targeting 100% of the recyclables rather than 25%. The food garbage, together with yard waste, would be composted. The 2nd container, taken to a material recovery facility, can separate out the paper, the cans, and the bottles in the usual way and market them. In other words, there is a very simple maneuver that could be made, providing that the city is prepared to process the food garbage together with the yard waste and make compost out of it. That is the critical missing element. People are entirely able to separate things into 3 containers. They're doing it now, but we're doing the wrong sort of separation to get intensive recycling. I think that New York City may be on the verge of changing because, as you know, we have a new mayor. And when Mr. Dinkins was campaigning, he said that he favored a moratorium on building incinerators and an effort on the part of the city to intensify recycling and push it as far as it will go. And so I hope that New York City will become the first city where recycling is pushed to its limit. And what its limit means is that it can be the method for recycling trash. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Commoner. I hope that we'll get back. I do have some questions for you and Mr. Beal, and especially on these percentages. We're going to have to rationalize what the 100% of whatever these percentages are. And I would almost want to ask a question here, but I'm afraid if I ask one, that'll lead to, it'll be addictive and it'll lead to more. So we'll give the others an opportunity to go ahead first. Mr. Hanlon, as you are being asked to testify, we are auspiciously bringing in some of the props that you have requested, and perhaps they can assist you, these visual aids here, we might call them, in your testimony. Proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Would you just tell us who you are and what you do?
Yes, my name is Dan Hanlon.
It's always chancy for us if you're in the federal establishment for to describe it.
I'm Dan Hanlon. I'm the Assistant Director of Engineering for the Architect of the Capitol. And let me say, Mr. Chairman, Mr. White sends his apologies. Unfortunately, he was unable to reorganize his schedule to be here. I also would like to request that we be given an opportunity to submit a written
We have copy. That statement, and which we thank you and Mr. White for, and we appreciate your attendance. Proceed.
Thank you. Before I get into the pilot program,
amend that. We don't have a statement prepared especially for this hearing, but we do have the solid waste management plan for the Capitol complex, which has been submitted, and that is what is being received without objection.
We'd also like to be able to submit a written statement.
The record will be held open for that purpose.
Thank you. Before I get into the pilot program, which we're beginning to initiate this week here on Capitol Hill, let me provide a little bit of background on our existing solid waste management program and strategies. Currently, we, within the Capitol complex, let me make that clear, the architect of the Capitol manages Capitol Hill, does not manage the executive branch office buildings, just the 210 acres which are confined in Capitol Hill, which include the Capitol, the House office buildings, the Senate office buildings, the Supreme Court, and the Library of Congress. Our current waste stream consists primarily of five constituents, dominated obviously by office waste, which is paper primarily. We also have a large quantity of construction waste because we're always doing building here. We also deal with wet waste from our kitchens and carryout facilities. We have yard waste from our grounds crews. We also have some hazardous waste, small quantities of that, which we deal with in a separate manner in accordance with EPA regulations. Currently, we are recycling approximately 70 to 80% of all paper that comes out of the Capitol complex. That is done through a cooperative effort with the General Services Administration through their Region 5 recycling program. The totals now are in the range of 6,000 tons, which represent about 50% of the Region 5 contributions to that program. We have recently been given directions through House Res 104 and Senate Res 99, as well as appropriation bill language, to develop and implement a pilot program. This pilot program is to expand our current recycling efforts to incorporate source separation within the suites. This program is directed towards the Rayburn House office building and the 5th and 6th floor of the Hart Senate office building, constituting approximately 4,000 participants, which is about 20% of our population here. The focus of the program, the goals of the program, if you will, are first and foremost to develop a database. Though we have a good handle on our waste stream, we know what's in it, we do not know specifically what's in it in terms of quantities and the value of the recyclables that are in it. Certainly, to help develop market or stimulate the market here in the region, Washington region is also another goal of the program, and we are exploring that with a variety of vendors. We also, as part of this sort of changing environment which we're looking at through the pilot program, evaluating collection strategies. Currently, our recycling is done through what we call a bulk recycling fashion. We collect the waste every night through our custodial forces that's delivered to the loading docks, and it's baled and put on a truck for delivering to the contractor, who then sends it on to a recycling plant of his choice. Payment for that is done directly to the Treasury through the General Services Administration. Currently, under the current contract, we are getting for grade 1 paper, grade 2 paper, and grade 3 paper, we're getting $80 a ton for grade 1, $40 a ton for grade 2, and $1 a ton for grade 3 or mixed paper. Because of the process that we have, the bulk recycling process, the dominant product that we put out for recycling is a mixed bale. So we're getting approximately $1 a ton for the bulk of our material that we're sending out. Again, a goal of the pilot program is to begin to separate out those grades of paper, so that not only can we realize the benefit of the cost increases from the market, but also allow us to target certain areas that need additional assistance.
Let me make sure we understand what you're saying. You're saying that at the present time, the grade 1 paper that is collected here in the Capitol is about 70% of the waste stream, is that right?
Not grade 1, paper in general.
Well, paper in general.
Of not the total waste stream.
Well, you're going to separate it in three categories, aren't you?
That's correct.
Well, what's the first category?
Would be bond paper.
That's grade 1.
Grade 1.
You get $80 for that.
$80 a ton.
Well, what's the second category?
That would be colored paper, bound reports.
And how much you get for that?
Manila folders. $40 a ton.
$40. And the other?
Grade 3 would be newsprint, magazines.
Yeah, what do you get for that?
$1 a ton.
And now you're only getting $1 a ton for the whole thing, since it is since the good stuff is contaminated by the cheap stuff, is that
it's
right?
It's a mixed bale, that's correct. Predominantly. Now,
when
we do
it's mixed, you get the lowest common denominator, is that right?
That's correct. Now, we do have opportunities...
From anybody? Isn't there anybody out there be willing to pay more? Even though, what percentage of the mixture is grade one? The
well,
white
stuff. That's part of getting your database developed.
You don't know, but what approximately?
I would say a good 50% of it.
50%. So a good 50%, you can get $80 a ton for.
40 to 50%.
And by mixing it up, which is what is being done now, you lose all that value, $79 a ton.
Well, there's a portion of it that we can capture as grade one when we have end runs from the print shops and overruns of newsletters, et cetera. Those are categorized as grade one and sent out as grade one. But predominantly, we are selling a mixed bale currently.
Just want to make sure I understood it. Thank you.
Also, as the final goal, probably most important goal of the pilot program, is to establish within each office a liaison. Efforts to date in other programs around the country have told us that without participation of an office liaison, in a sense championing the program within their particular office, the success failure is limited. And the success of the pilot program, by the way, is really depends on the staff participation in the pilot. The forces of the architect of the Capitol will do their part of it. We'll make sure that we collect, weigh, collate the material in accordance with our agreements with the General Services Administration. But really, we're looking towards the staffs to be the main focus of this expanded effort, not necessarily our forces, although our forces will have to change the way they normally do business. The timing for this, as I said, is we are beginning to set up the suites within Rayburn this week. Let me talk about the philosophy within the suites for a moment and describe some of the containers.
Props here. Are you going to tell us what they are?
Yes, I'm just getting to that. The philosophy behind the program is to continue our standard operating procedure, which is to have minimal impact on the office suites by the custodial forces. So each container will be emptied every night. Each person participating in the pilot program, and by the way, this is a volunteer program, Mr. Chairman, not a mandatory program. We have had about 70% of those within Rayburn who have volunteered for the program
70%?
To date. About 70%. Each individual.
I want to proudly announce that our office is one of that's part
yes,
of that 70%.
Yes, I know.
And I didn't even motivate it.
Each individual in the participating offices will be given a desktop recycler, similar to the one that's there on my right, your left. It is divided into two sections and will be clearly labeled as to what goes in each section. The first section will be bond paper or grade one. The second section will be grade two, or bound reports and colored paper. Grade three, the newspapers, magazines, corrugated products, will be deposited into a larger container similar to the ones that are stacked. Correct.
That's a gray, blue, and maroon?
Gray, blue, and red. Correct. There actually will be four of them, the top one being newsprint, and then the next three being collectibles, containers to collect glass, plastics, and cans. The container
to the far. Will there be one of those for each desk?
No, sir. I'm sorry.
That's for each office.
For each office suite, we'll get a set of stackables, and they'll be located in a central location. In addition to that, at Xerox machines, mail rooms, and other areas that have a large quantity of grade one paper or bond paper produced, we've developed this larger box, which will accept larger quantities of grade one material. As part of the program, we are also asking each of the participating suites, not only in Rayburn, but also in Longworth and Cannon, to begin to establish a central depository for their wet waste. The organic contaminants and the recycle cause us a lot of problems, and we're hoping to attack that problem with the cooperation of the office staffs. There's been a lot of interest, obviously, in the Cannon and Longworth building about participating in the program, and we will be providing regional recycling stations on every floor of the Cannon and Longworth building at some future date once those locations have been identified and approved.
For the record, there are three house office buildings here, Cannon, Longworth, and Rayburn, Rayburn being the one we're in right now. I don't know whether you mentioned that or not, but even if you did, it should be restated.
That's correct.
For those many people who may be observing or may observe this hearing, what we're talking about is the three house office buildings.
In addition to the two annexes, Annex 1 and Annex 2.
That's where we have the slaves, the staff, right?
Right. We have done a fairly comprehensive job in trying to capture the good elements of programs around the country and bring them to Capitol Hill and to this special environment to try to develop a program that will be successful. We've produced several publications. Chairman Bates, chairman of the House Administration Subcommittee on Procurement and Printing, has done an excellent job in putting a good article together in roll call that appeared in, I believe, November 20th issue. And that also was distributed by him through a dear colleague recently. Our office has put together a little brochure which basically outlines the program, the pilot program, and has the details of separation and some photographs on it, promotional literature. These have been passed out through our orientation sessions, Mr. Chairman, which were given last week to all of those participating office. They will also be attached to the desktop recycler when they are set up in the offices. Hopefully, we will complete that setup by the time Congress returns on the 23rd. That concludes my remarks. I'm happy to answer any questions now or some.
And we're going to publish the names of the offices that are not participating, is that right? We're talking about incentives and disincentives.
I'll leave that up to you, Mr. Chairman.
Well, let's threaten it anyway. Thank you very much, Mr. Hanlon. Perhaps we better next go to Mr. Jenkins, since he's representing the city, and then we'll have Mr. Bentz perhaps comment on the Washington, D.C. program. That might be at least as logical a way to approach it. Mr. Jenkins, you're the recycling department in the city of Washington, D.C., and we have your prepared statement, for which we appreciate. And you may proceed in any way you think will be helpful.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm honored to be here with other municipalities to testify about the District of Columbia's recycling program. Our program was initiated this past October as a result of the enactment of our law called DC Law 7-226, the Solid Waste Management and Multi-Materials Recycling Act of 1988. Although our program, we call it ambitious, has just begun, we're proud of our accomplishments and we have many experiences to share. Like many jurisdictions across the country, two overriding issues served as a catalyst in the development of the district's recycling law. First, district residents and businesses generate approximately 2,000 tons of trash a day. That's equivalent to 600 trash trucks going to Lorton every day. Such an enormous amount of waste threatens our limited landfill space, which will expire in 1992, given the current rate of trash generation. As a throwaway society, more and more commodities of value are disposed of each year, depleting natural resources and stifling the development of reusable, recyclable products. Also, traditional methods of waste disposal, such as incineration and landfilling, have become less and less acceptable from both an environmental and public policy standpoint. The public, rightfully so, is holding public officials and lawmakers environmentally accountable for yesterday's, today's, and tomorrow's decisions affecting the environment. Our program, we call it ambitious because we cover so many aspects of recycling and also because we're doing so much in such a short time. Our law is mandatory for both district residents, businesses, federal entities, local government entities, universities, and most businesses that are of a commercial sector in our city that have offices. Unlike other jurisdictions, the district law requires us to implement the program without the benefit of a pilot program or voluntarism, as you're doing currently in the Capitol. Our approach has been to learn from the experiences of other recycling municipalities and to meet with as many residents and businesses as possible to discuss their needs and concerns regarding our law. Our overall goal is to divert 45% of our total waste stream by 1994. In the diversion, we will recycle various commodities. To accomplish this, the district was required to develop a residential newspaper and yard waste recycling program beginning in October 1989, as well as an office paper program for district businesses and governmental establishments. This year, the district must develop a program which encompasses both metals and glass for district residents and businesses. Other programs the district will develop include a monthly household hazardous waste program, recycling of construction and demolition waste, as well as plastics and tires, and various other issues enumerated in our recycling law. To date, the district has accomplished the following. We've developed recycling rules and regulations which affect district residents and businesses. Incidentally, our rules and regulations were passed by our city council just this past week. We've established a newspaper recycling program for 100,000 district-served single-family households, including where we're utilizing our in-house collection vehicle and our own personnel. We've identified new and emergency newspaper markets, despite the newspaper glut affecting much of the East Coast. We have 10 markets that will take all of our paper. I think that's a new issue for everybody to note. We've developed a commercial recycling plan that was mailed to approximately 40,000 businesses. We have to target our audiences. We can't publicize and generate information about our recycling program for everybody. It has to be targeted. We've met with hundreds of residents and business groups to discuss the mandatory provisions and requirements of our law. We've developed a public education program that has included mailings to district residents and public service announcements for radio and cable television. And we also provide you with a sample of all we've done in terms of our advertisement for our program in this kit, which you currently have. We've developed market agreements for our metals and glass. We've purchased 4 vehicles for recyclable collection. And we're currently implementing a recyclable collection program for condominiums and cooperatives. Getting to costs, our recycling program is funded by a $5 surcharge on the tip fee charged to haulers who dump their trash at the Lorton landfill. The fiscal year 1990 recycling budget is $4.2 million. To date, approximately $1.2 million has been spent. These costs include the cost of newspaper collection from residential household, equipment purchases, salaries, and public education activities. We have several issues we'd like to bring to your attention. First is condominiums and cooperatives. Under this recycling law, the district must collect recyclables from any condominium or cooperative requesting the service. This provision will increase our household collection requirement from 100,000 to 133,000 in less than a year. Markets. Marketing is one of the most critical steps in the recycling process. Materials can be collected, but if they are not sold or reused, recycling does not happen. The district has experienced firsthand the impact of the glutted newspaper market. We have been successful in recent weeks to identify new and emerging markets for post-consumer newspaper. Changing public perceptions of waste, this has been talked about before. Our recycling program and its mandated provisions have required district residents and businesses to view and treat waste differently than before. Educating the public to view waste as a commodity rather than garbage is an ongoing activity of the recycling office. I can count numerous experiences and lessons that we've learned in these 3 short months of program implementation. It is our position that all levels of government and citizens alike must take responsibility for the environment we've created. I would like to say, Chairman Lucan, that we applaud the efforts of our council lady, Nadine Winter, and she's currently pushing forth legislation to help create a market for our newspapers here by requiring publishers and distributors of paper to have 40% recycled content. And we applaud your efforts and those of others in the passage of those bills that pertain to taxing virgin materials. Thank you.
One question at this point before we call on Mr. Bentz. Mr. Hanlon has testified for the architect here with reference to federal, and that is the Capitol, federal agencies and departments and the Congress on Capitol Hill. I understand that the haulers of the waste from Capitol Hill are private, is that right? Those who haul away the waste, is that right? The city.
Our non-recyclables, yes, sir, are hauled by private
non-recyclables.
Haulers. We do haul some of the waste ourselves. We do have our own trucks and facilities.
For recyclables?
No, our recyclables, primarily the paper, is taken out by a GSA contractor.
contract.
Who handles the entire federal Region 5.
But the city of Washington, D.C. does not.
No, they do not.
Does not participate in the disposal or in the recycling efforts from that Mr. Hanlon described. Isn't that right, Mr. Jenkins?
That's partially right. We're working with GSA on that in trying to get more and more federal agencies involved in the program. In fact, we are using some of the same materials.
You're working so far as planning?
Yes, we are.
But not currently?
Not currently.
Okay. I apologize for the interruption, Mr. Bentz. And we appreciate your coming today to offer your comments at our request. We have your testimony, which you've been kind enough to give us. Without objection, it'll be received. And you may proceed in any way you think will be helpful. Thank
you. Okay. This testimony is fairly lengthy. Would you like to hear the whole thing or a summary?
We'd like you to keep to about 5 minutes, and summary would be fine.
Okay. I think I'll just summarize the key elements.
It will be in the record.
Okay. My name is Brian Bentz, and I'm the Recycling Campaign Coordinator for Greenpeace Action in Washington, D.C., and I thank the chairman for this opportunity to testify this afternoon.
Well, could I interrupt at one point? Councilwoman Winter, who has been mentioned, was to be here, and she unfortunately is ill today. She has a severe case of the flu, I understand, and we regret that, but otherwise she would be here.
Okay. Greenpeace Action was one of the driving forces behind passage of the local D.C. recycling law. We did grassroots lobbying and direct lobbying for that particular piece of legislation, and we think it's a really important step forward in creating a new way of addressing the garbage problem. The D.C. recycling program is ambitious. I think contrary to some of the skeptics of recycling, the problems in D.C. are not related to the public's willingness to recycle or recycling technologies. In the District of Columbia, I think the primary problem is the political motivation and commitment to mobilize all the resources that are available to put all the emphasis on waste reduction, recycling, and composting. I think that's our primary analysis of the situation here in Washington, D.C. There are 7 specific suggestions and recommendations that Greenpeace Action has for improving the Washington, D.C. program. As Mr. Jenkins noted, there's over $4 million in the recycling fund here in Washington, D.C. I think it's time we start utilizing the money for the program. Most city agencies are strapped for funds and don't have enough money to implement programs. I think here we're in a particularly fortunate situation to have funds available to initiate a large-scale intensive recycling program. Second, I think we need to get a much more visible public profile in terms of public education, advertising. I would also suggest and recommend the participation of the mayor. We need to see a forthright, clear commitment from the local political leadership to promote this recycling program. This is also an area where I think the federal government has a role. I know that the Bush administration has made environmental issues a priority, and I think it would be appropriate and useful for either representatives from the Environmental Protection Agency or the White House itself to promote recycling here in the nation's capital. Third, I'll echo comments made by Dr. Commoner. I think we need to set aside plans to build a new incinerator here in the District of Columbia. Our city government drafted a comprehensive solid waste management plan, which they submitted to the City Council this fall, and it includes an enormous expenditure of $130 million to retrofit our existing incinerator, which is dilapidated and barely functioning, and convert this facility into a so-called resource recovery or waste-to-energy facility. When you analyze the comprehensive solid waste management plan put forward by the city, you see that $130 million out of $160 million total is being earmarked and directed towards revitalizing the incineration component of a solid waste management program. So I think that I want to echo and agree with Dr. Commoner's comments that we need to, in order to really maximize the potential of waste reduction and recycling and composting, we need to have a moratorium on these incineration facilities. And Greenpeace Action suggests that that moratorium be of a duration for 5 years, so that municipal officials here in Washington and throughout the country can devote all of their energies and resources towards intensive recycling programs. Fourth, I think our local recycling ordinance could be amended to raise the recycling goal from 45% of municipal solid waste to at least 75%. Fifth, we have a problem with marketing our collected newsprint, and that's been dealt with fairly extensively here today. And Council Member Nadine Winter of the local DC Council has introduced a bill that will require newspaper publishers to buy recycled newsprint, also require the vendors of paper products to sell recycled paper. And Greenpeace Action supports this legislation. We hope that similar initiatives are organized throughout the country. And this is another key area where the federal government has a leadership role. It's codified in the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act that the EPA would issue procurement guidelines for recycled products to direct federal procurement agencies to start purchasing recycled paper products and other recycled goods. I think that this is an area where the federal government has enormous influence, and we really need to spur those actions forward. Sixth, I think that we should make Washington, D.C. the model recycling program for the nation and draw in the resources of the federal government and the local government and make a big push to establish the most comprehensive recycling program in the country and use it as an example for other municipalities and jurisdictions throughout the country. Finally, I think that I'll just close by saying that I appreciate the opportunity to present this testimony. I think that Greenpeace Action reflects the concerns of grassroots activists, ordinary citizens, and this is reflected on the policy level in a desire to have the most ambitious recycling programs possible, and for the time being, for a duration of several years, have a moratorium on the solid waste incineration facilities. I thank you for the opportunity to testify.
Mr. Beale, are you familiar with this report the City of New York submitted dated January the 11th? In answer to our questions, you have the letter. It did refer to incinerator somewhere. Would you find that for me, did it not? Incineration as an issue? Or did it? Or did your testimony today did not, did it?
No. And I don't believe the letter did either. I don't.
Does the city program and
we submitted a white paper that was written back in, that was published back in January of 1988. That was the white paper. We refer to it as the white paper. And that was focused primarily on waste reduction and recycling, but it called for an integrated solid waste management strategy that includes also incinerate, well, resource recovery plants as well as landfilling, and address those issues. But I don't recall it being in the letter.
Well, I don't think I read that, and I did read the, well, in any event, what is the position of the department today on the subject?
We support strongly an integrated solid waste management plan. We believe that no one or two single solid waste management strategies are sufficient.
And that's where Mr. Commoner might not agree, right? Mr. Commoner?
That's right.
Yes, I could respond to...
You made that very clear. You can. Just let me introduce the subject this way. I think I'm inclined to, although I don't know that we can exclude absolutely the possibility of incinerators in any situation. Nevertheless, I am strongly inclined at this point to agree with basically what I think Mr. Commoner said, and which I tried to say, and I think he said it much more eloquently in his statement, that if we're going to solve this national waste crisis, and I think it is a crisis, we're going to have to realize that there's going to be a sense of urgency required, that we're going to have to go the last mile and then beyond the last mile in our efforts. And that's why earlier when I was talking to the city of Cincinnati, I wasn't being critical. When I was talking to the other cities and referring to the other cities across the country who haven't even gotten that far, that they haven't come to that sense of urgency. And once they do, you know, necessity is the mother of invention, they're going to get much further along. And part of our job, although we're not Sunday morning homilists, but part of our job through the legislation certainly is to instruct and to educate, not only with the carrot and the stick, but also in the way we frame the legislation. But further, in introducing this subject for our discussion, I would like to ask each one of you whether you believe that a commitment to recycling and waste reduction on the part of the entire city or community structure, meaning the mayor, the council, and the establishment, will eliminate the need for incinerators. I don't know whether you've answered that, but by way of introduction, go ahead. You said you wanted to respond, Ms. Stabile.
Yeah,
Ms. Stabile.
You want to say something.
Yes,
go ahead.
I do.
We'll start from left to right.
Okay.
I realize I was did address to Mr. Commoner, too. So we'll start off, Ms. Stabile.
New York City had originally planned to build 8 resource recovery plants, and with the mandating of Local Law 19, which is our mandatory recycling bill, it's now been cut back to 5. And we are in the process of trying to get approval to build 1 resource recovery plant. We feel we have...
For the benefit of the general public, you mean an incinerator?
An incinerator, I'm sorry. It burns garbage, yes, and produces energy.
That's jargon that we use, and I've learned to use, but I remember when I started out using this jargon that I wasn't sure what a resource recovery plant was.
Yes. We feel we have embarked on an ambitious recycling plan. We have said publicly that 25% is the minimum target for recycling. Our waste composition study is in very large part to help us learn more about the waste stream that we have to target and to determine overall what is the best strategy for handling all our waste. We are presently undergoing a huge solid waste management plan that will be submitted to the state this year. One of the things that has been said by my colleagues before me in the previous panel is that you can't underestimate the need for markets and the need for processing capacity. You don't simply collect these materials separately and they become recyclable. We are having a very difficult time finding markets. I agree with Dr. Commoner in that you evaluate markets not based on whether you pay or receive revenue, but whether the avoided cost makes it beneficial and whether people will use this material for recycling purposes. The City of New York is now embarked on a series of contracts where we are paying to have our newspapers, magazines, and corrugated turned into recyclables. So we have not avoided this issue. We have also been working very closely with members from citizens advisory committees to establish intensive recycling zones. Food waste is one of the materials clearly been targeted to evaluate, assess, and possibly implement programs. But you don't simply ask residents to separate their food waste. You need to have a place to bring this food waste, and you have to have a place where it can be then composted. Siting is not something anyone in this room can underestimate. We have trouble siting garage facilities because they're simply associated with garbage. It's a truck. It picks up garbage, but it is not garbage. And we have difficulty siting them. Trying to site any type of landfill management facility will be difficult. A food waste facility will be even more difficult. It does not mean we will not pursue that issue, but we have to recognize some of the constraints in doing any of this. Mixed paper is something, Mr. Commoner had said that you simply redirect your efforts in terms of three bundles. One would be your mixed paper and your bottles and cans. Part of our intensive recycling effort has been to explore mixed paper, and frankly, we expect to be collecting some component of the mixed paper waste stream. But to date, our consultants have been unable to identify markets that will take our mixed waste mixed with newspapers, magazines, and corrugated, much less mixed with bottles and cans. We have to get residents to rinse those bottles and cans so that the material is not recovered, is not contaminated. Of all the materials we collect in our metal and glass program, 100% of it is not recovered as recyclables. We lose about 5%, and we think that's pretty good recovery rate because of contaminants that get in there. When we talk about mixed paper, you have to remember it's not just junk mail. It's how the junk mail is sent to you. If the window has a plastic envelope, window in it, that makes it more difficult to recycle. It includes your paper towels, which may be dirty. It includes the roll that the paper towel is on. It includes a diverse number of different types of materials. You heard one of the colleagues speak about the degradation in the quality and ability to market materials the more you mix them. Once you mix all these, yes, you can separate them as long as you ask the residents to put them out in certain ways. Our programs have been targeted to make it as easy for the residents to participate, as well as where we know we have markets or can encourage the markets to exist. We are working very hard to identify and encourage new markets, but it is not simply you go out and collect the materials. You need a place to bring them.
Thank you, Mr. Bill. Dr. Commoner.
Well, I think the situation in New York is a good test case for the kinds of questions that you raise. And let me just outline what the situation is in New York. You notice that the city is now preparing a waste management plan. Now, obviously, a plan ought to precede what you do. But the city previously had committed itself first to 8 incinerators, and now to 5. And now, after the fact, a plan is being devised. That begins to give you some sense of the problem. If a plan had been done first, the plan would show that you can recycle more of the trash than an incinerator can burn. An incinerator burns 70% of the trash. What's left over is toxic ash, and incidentally, that has become a very serious problem for the city because there's no place to dispose of toxic ash in the city. That's the first point. Now, the business of integrated waste management brings the incinerator in a way that interferes with recycling. The point that has to be made is this. The facilities that you need to process recycled material can be built a lot faster than an incinerator. For example, the material recovery facility that does the separation that you need to handle paper, cans, and bottles A facility of that sort can be built in a year, as against several years at least, for building an incinerator. It involves smaller capital units of investment. In fact, the capital involved is much more efficiently used in these facilities than in incineration. In the material I gave you, there is a table on simply the capital expenditure differences. There we simply took the figure, $562 million, which is the cost of the proposed incinerator at the Brooklyn Navy Yard, and that will handle 3,000 tons a day. The same amount of money spent for an intensive recycling program will handle 5,000 tons a day. Another way to look at it is in a previous chart that I gave you, the one you asked about, the peculiar 4,617 tons. Now, that was an exercise that we did in order to see how you would change the area that would be serving the Brooklyn Navy Yard incinerator, and as it happened, you could get that amount of tonnage from that area. And so we simply ran through an exercise there saying, what would it cost the city? And this involves all of the capital expenditures as well as the operating expenditures. And intensive recycling comes down to $167 per ton total. And the present or planned city program, which involves 25% recycling and the rest being incinerated, that comes to $195 a ton. And we were being very generous about what it would cost to take care of the toxic ash, because that's essentially an unsolved problem that may turn out to be very expensive. What I'm saying is that the rational way for a city to go about dealing with its trash is first to analyze the problem. The analysis will show that intensive recycling, including food garbage composting, can take care of the problem more quickly, more cheaply than incineration. Yes, you may need an incinerator, for example, to burn unrecyclable plastic. But if you build an incinerator first, you have no idea what you're going to need to burn. And, for example, the Brooklyn Navy Yard incinerator wouldn't be appropriate for burning plastic, because much of the plastic will produce acid, and you'll need a very special kind of incinerator to do that. So the strategy should be to set up an intensive recycling program, push it as far as you can. Down the line, it's possible, if we don't cut back on our use of plastic, much of which can't be recycled, that you may need to have a way of burning that rather than landfilling it. But at that point, you would need to design a very special kind of incinerator, so that incineration should be looked at as something that you bring in only when and if it is necessary. In fact, every city I know of has gone about it in the reverse way. Incinerators have been committed. Now, in many places, public opposition has stopped it. Stopped it in Los Angeles, Philadelphia, and with our new mayor, it looks as though it may have stopped it in New York. But the sensible, constructive way to go about it is to begin with recycling and develop that as far as you can. And what I think will happen will be you'll then find that you have no need for an incinerator.
Dr. Commoner, I believe you said that, and you just reflected it, reiterated, I believe, again, that with the change of administration, Mayor Dinkins had stated in his campaign that he was considering or committed to, whichever it is, a moratorium on incinerators, right?
Yeah.
As a practical matter, there aren't any incinerators in New York at present.
No, but the Brooklyn Navy Yard incinerator has
so
been...
It, So the issue comes up by way of the plans, not by way of the actual current operation?
No, there are incinerators operating in New York. They're old, small,
old-fashioned ones. They're small, old ones,
yeah. The Brooklyn Navy Yard incinerator...
Isn't it true that over 90% of the waste in Cincinnati is disposed in that fresh kills?
Yeah, and that's right.
The landfill.
The Navy Yard incinerator is in the stage of applying for a permit from the state. The state has said it would grant a permit if the city can find a suitable way of getting rid of the toxic ash from the incinerator. The city has not done that yet. The question that comes up is, will that permit be pursued or not?
With regard to fresh kills, that has been described as a quintessential American trash depository, it's also been described as a place from which a river of leachate, of acidic leachate, constantly right. runs off.
Right.
You'd agree with that? Would you agree with that?
Oh, yeah.
Mr.
Well, you see, landfill.
Fresh kills, by the way, that's
area.
Fresh kills. The name originally, it's a Dutch.
Well, kill,
kill
is a creek.
Kill is that Dutch?
Dutch for creek. And fresh kills sits the landfill sits right at the creek. The reason being that barges are used to bring the trash. It's on marshy ground, and it is simply the wrong place to have a landfill. There's no question about it. There now the city is faced, if it builds an incinerator, with a necessity of putting fly ash in this mess. And I think that would make for very serious difficulties.
Just fly ash, or how about bottom ash?
Well, both.
You mean incinerator ash?
Yeah,
generally.
Both. Mm-hmm. And they're toxic. And if you need to ship it out of the city, it's going to get increasingly expensive because there are very few landfills that are prepared to take that.
Well, the philosophy of our legislation, which I believe is stated in the legislation, which we're considering, is that there is a hierarchy of values, which you have stated, and that we go from source reduction, which is the most preferred way, obviously, don't create the waste, to recycling. And only when recycling won't do the job do we go to incineration.
Right.
So we all adopt it in principle. But you say that the Conference of Mayors, it's your experience, do they formally have a department?
Yeah, they
that's
have a subsidiary called the Resource Recovery Association. And as a matter of fact, we rely, my institute relies on the U.S. Conference of Mayors for a lot of our information about incinerators. They put out a very valuable newsletter about the construction of incinerators. I don't see that kind of information about recycling. But let me say this. They're not alone. Take New York State. New York State has officially adopted the hierarchy: reduction, recycling, incineration, landfilling. But it has put well over 10 times more money into supporting incineration than recycling. In other words, what integrated waste management means is, well, we'll do all of this. You stated it in a much more accurate way. That is, we will do reduction and recycling until we've exhausted the possibility, then we'll look at incineration. That is not what is done, for example, in New York State. In New York State, the Department of Environmental Conservation will say to the community, you want to build an incinerator, then you have to show us that you're going to do recycling also. That's exactly what it said to New York City. And I have to tell you, the reason why we got a 25% recycling bill is that the state insisted on it. The Koch administration opposed that bill. Now, that is not the position that you stated. What that says is, yes, you can build an incinerator, but do give us a little recycling. And that is exactly the wrong approach, but that's what integrated waste management means in practice. In other words, this hierarchy has been set up and basically ignored. Yet, The facts are that if the hierarchy were properly followed, we would have a far more environmentally sound way of trash disposal. We would have a cheaper way. And incidentally, it's good for the city's economy. We did a study for the city of Buffalo comparing incineration and intensive recycling. And what we showed was that if you used incineration, the money spent by the city for trash disposal would go to some multinational corporation and leave the city's economy. On the other hand, if the money was spent for intensive recycling, it means more jobs among sanitation workers. It means setting up the processing facilities. It also means that you can attract to the city new industry that will use the secondary materials. In other words, for any city, take New York, which has financial problems, which is losing manufacturing, if we went to a recycling, it would become a more economic way to spend the city's money, and it would build up the city's economy. Now, in the face of all that, you have to ask, well, why aren't we doing it? And the only answer I can give you is that the incinerator industry got the jump on us and put an awful lot of pressure on municipalities to move in that direction.
Well, there's also, I think, a popular conception, which hasn't totally disappeared, that when something is consumed by fire, it disappears.
Well, of course, it doesn't. The incinerators...
Well, we know it doesn't. It produces the fly ash, it produces the ambient stuff, and it also provides the ash, which fly ash, if it's properly collected, or the bottom ash, which, as you say, is a very serious problem as to its toxicity that hasn't been decided. We are trying to work it out in this legislation and provide that since we're going to have the stuff, and we got a bunch of the stuff anyway, we got to dispose of it, and we're doing it through a requirement of state-of-the-art landfills and monofills with the proper liners and leachate collection systems, groundwater monitoring, and so on. I think we're moving in the right direction where incinerators actually exist or necessarily exist. What we're talking now, of course, is about whether they should exist, whether we should create more, and so on. So I agree with you. And I have seen it happen, and I won't state where, but I have seen it happen where a city goes into a planning and just absolutely assumes that incinerators are the route to go and put the engineers on the job without considering first what they should do. But as to the planning, it is a chicken and egg proposition. Since you're planning down the road, it's hard to say not to include incinerators, absolutely not, because it might be possible, and whether you can afford to try recycling and how long you try it before and to what extent, to what amount of dedication and devotion to the program would be required before you say recycling hasn't done the job. Those are questions that you're very clearly stating your position on it, and I'm inclined to agree with very much of it, but those are the...
Well, you heard from Seattle how fast the program in Seattle is going faster than they expected. And we're seeing...
That's what New York said.
Well, New York...
You didn't necessarily agree with
it. New York hasn't, I think, progressed as fast as Seattle.
No. No, I say New York said there was progressing faster than they expected.
Well,
in New York,
it depends on what the expectations are.
Maybe they had modest ambitions.
Yes. But
many of us suffer from a lack of ambition.
Well, I think you're absolutely right. We have to declare that this is the ambitious thing to do, and it's going to be done. And I think what I found is people will back you on that. This is what they want to do.
I think we'll come back and let you add a postscript.
I have to leave.
Take a minute or two?
Yeah, and I apologize. It's just I'm also involved in the budget process. I just will quickly say that New York City is definitely recycling. We have 1 million households on that have come on in 2.5 years, 2.5 years, that we will be recycling 40% of the waste stream by 1994. That is not a minimum. That is a minimum. That is not a maximum goal. We're very proud of our efforts, and we feel we're taking a lot of planning steps to increase that, including working with Mr. Commoner and others on developing intensive recycling zones to explore more of the waste stream. And we haven't built a resource recovery plant yet.
All right, thank you very much. Will remain open for you to offer further comments on Dr. Commoner's testimony or anything else you may want to add. We do want to talk to Mr. Jenkins for a bit about the Washington situation. District residents and businesses generate 2,000 tons of trash per day, which you state will cause the district's landfill space to expire in 1992. That's 2 years away, isn't it? Maybe less. Is it that bad in Washington, D.C.?
Well, it's that bad in terms of landfill space that's available.
Well,
so we've got to do something.
On the face of it, there doesn't appear to be a match here. There doesn't appear to be a recycling program or any other program that's going to significantly reduce this waste stream.
Well, in 2 years. Well, by 1992, our goal is to be at 35% of the total waste stream. We've already witnessed in the first quarter of this year a significant reduction in terms of the total waste disposed.
How much of the total waste stream have you reduced?
Total waste stream actually reduced. Yeah, this first quarter we've...
First quarter what?
This year, fiscal 1990? Year 90. Fiscal year 90.
What months are those?
November, December.
Okay.
All right. We've reduced the waste stream by... we've had an average of 166,400 tons. We've had 166,400 tons for the first quarter.
Reduction?
No, that's what we've generated so far, this quarter. Now, if we prorate that across the four quarters, that would give us an annual rate of 665,600 tons, as opposed to last year's tonnage, which was 740,000 tons. So already, we're looking at a reduction of 74,500 tons for the year.
And what percentage is that? Approximately? Sounds like it's about...
Already that's 10%.
10%?
Already. That's just in source reduction before recycling.
But you're taking the newspapers, which is a lot of the volume, and perhaps the easiest to do, right? In volume.
No, the newspapers are already included in the total tonnage.
That's your reduction, is primarily
not
in
yet.
Newspaper?
Not yet.
Well, what are you reducing?
Reducing from that is what... the percentages will be.
But your reductions are in newspaper. That's the only thing you're recycling, isn't it?
No. Yard waste, newspapers, and office papers. So it shows
Where's the yard waste going?
Our yard waste is currently being stockpiled. We're going to RFP
it. So you haven't reduced that. You've stockpiled it, which means you still got the waste.
No, Congressman Lucan. The yard waste is not in the landfill. It's diverted.
But it's diverted to another place. It's still waste until you actually compost it, isn't it?
It will be composted by contract.
But it hasn't been yet.
No, not yet. It's not due yet.
So you've just moved the waste from one place to the other.
No, we diverted it from the landfill. So it's not in the landfill, which is critical space that we're trying to save. And I think that's obvious.
But it's not any place where you can leave it.
Yes, it is.
Or else you're going to create another problem.
No, we're stockpiling it in a safe place.
Stockpiling?
Right.
That's not a term of art, is it? Mr. Benz, do you think they're... What are we doing with the yard waste here in Washington?
I would characterize it as being in storage or stockpiled. Obviously, it's not a situation that lends itself to a lot of efficiency in a composting program or a recycling program. According to other officials in the Office of Recycling, they indicate that a bid for a long-term composting contract is if not imminent, coming up within the next few months. I think part of what's happened here is that in trying to adhere to the exact specifications of the local ordinance, the city recycling office has occasionally done things where they've gone out and initiated a recycling activity that they do not have the infrastructure, the physical infrastructure, the spaces, the equipment that's necessary to actually finish the job that they started. So that's why you have the situation where we have newspapers in a storage pit at our city incinerator and yard waste at three or four different sites around the city. So obviously, well, what's needed is...
In a very real sense, then, if we're storing newspapers somewhere, we've just moved the waste from one point to another, have we not?
Well, whether it's recycling or landfilling or incineration, that's always something that's going
on. But storing is neither one of the four, or three.
That's correct. It's not a healthy situation for a recycling program.
It's not disposal, it's storage.
Storage, right. I think that the Office of Recycling in the D.C. government have made some very credible attempts to get the program going on the timeline that was created through the legislation. It's very,
it's
very rapid.
It's not our purpose to dwell on these problems.
I think what needs to be done is we need the political commitment from our city administration, city government, to give the green light for
this
program.
On that subject, I have one or two questions. What about the question of spending the money that's been appropriated, Mr. Jenkins?
I think the question was unfair. If you look at $1.2 million based on a $4.2 million budget, this is the first quarter, that's approximately one-fourth of that money.
What about that, Mr. Bentz? Is that right?
Pardon me?
I thought you made that critical evaluation.
Right. Well,
that they're not spending
initially the
Jenkins
problem
says they are spending it.
They are spending money now. Initially, the problem was is that the city council directed $200,000 to the Public Works Department to create a recycling office and have it staffed. This was back in the end of 1988. The problem from Greenpeace Action's point of view and a number of other citizen recycling groups is that the actual office was not created and the staffing for the office did not occur until April of 1990, this past year. So there was this gap of 5 or 6 months when the funds were available within the city government to create this office, get some people working in there. Before it actually happened, there was a five-month gap. So that frustrated and angered a lot of people in the grassroots recycling community, and it forced them to question the city's commitment, particularly the Public Works Department and the Berry administration. You know, it forced them to question their commitment about recycling.
I'm still not clear, and I'll just let it go after a question or two, but I'm still not clear what Washington, D.C. is going to do. It's out of land space right around the corner, out of landfilling space. And this program, you think this recycling program is going to reduce the waste stream enough to make that landfill space that's available stretch out for a long time?
At this point in time, we're a fledgling program, and we're 3 months down the road. We've, I think, in overall reduction.
Yeah, well, you got a tiny fire pumper, but you got a big fire.
No. Our landfill's not on fire.
Well, I'm using an analogy. Well, you got a fledgling program, but you got a big problem.
Well, see, a fire is confrontatory, and it'll spread. Our landfill problem is different than a fire. I hate to differ with you.
Okay.
What you do when you save space is that you allot that space, you give time to yourself. So space means time to us. So by, say, for example, we've separated or collected something like 3,931 tons of newspapers from October. If you multiply that by 3.3 cubic yards, you can get a feel for the kind of space we've just saved in a landfill in just that short time, just with yard waste, newspapers. With yard waste, we've collected 5,000 tons. Multiply that by the same figures, you can get a better feel for miles and miles of landfill space that we have saved. So that translates into time that you have to use a landfill. As we bring the program on the line with more commodities for recycling, then that further extends the life of the landfill. So we can go beyond 1992.
With the present landfill?
With the present landfill.
You're not planning incinerator?
The incinerator, I think, is very good for one purpose. Hospital waste. Infectious waste. We ought to burn it.
Aren't the hospitals taking care of their own?
In some cases, D.C. provides that service. It's also good for certain sectors of the federal government where you macerate paper. You will not recycle it because it's confidential. We should incinerate that paper.
Mr. Lucan.
Dr. Commoner.
I'm impelled to remark that it would be a monstrous mistake to mix infectious waste with regular household waste in an incinerator. There are various reasons for it. For one thing, the difficulty of handling the infectious waste in the midst of a big, massive influx of ordinary waste would be terrible. The other thing is, there's a lot of polyvinyl chloride in the hospital waste, a lot of the plastic material. That's exactly the source of the dioxin that incinerators synthesize. I think the city of D.C. better decide right off the bat whether it's dealing with medical waste in that incinerator or whether that incinerator is designed to deal with household and commercial waste. Otherwise, you're going to get into a very serious problem.
Are you doing any of that today, Dr. Jenkins? Are you mixing?
No, I'm not.
Is the city of Washington, D.C., if you know, mingling hospital waste with other waste?
No, I run the recycling program, and that's the extent to which I could respond to your question. As to the specifics that are, you know, go into an incinerator, I couldn't tell you that.
You don't have an incinerator currently, do you?
We have an incinerator.
How much of the waste in the municipal stream is being incinerated in Washington, D.C.?
Very little.
Small amount, but you do have some
city-operated
incinerators.
In the first 3 months of this year, we've incinerated something in the neighborhood of 15,000 tons.
15 out of 700-some thousand?
It's very low.
You know if any of that is medical waste?
I would think that probably some might be. I'm not positive.
Well, we'll hold the record open and ask for...
For a follow-up.
...you to check with the other part of the Public Works Department and give us a response to the issues raised by Dr. Commoner, and which...
I'd like to respond to Dr. Commoner's comment. Hospitals now currently do incinerate their medical waste.
Yes, in a dedicated incinerator.
But he was objecting to the fact that apparently your suggestion was, or the suggestion
and
to the concept that these would be mixed with other municipal waste in the incinerating process.
Well, I don't know that we burn out and then just do that separately or not. It may be a process involved or a procedure. But any furnace that's used for burning of infectious waste probably handles it the same way, whether it's dedicated for that purpose or not. So the same threat, you know, results from it, and that's the dioxin that you mentioned.
Well, I'm not satisfied that the hospitals are handling that waste correctly. And as a matter of fact, the investigation that we've made on the subject, we've come to the conclusion that the hospitals don't even want to discuss it with us, and they don't want to report it to anybody. And I'd be surprised if anybody knows just what they are doing with it exactly. They seem to think they're a law unto themselves, and I've told that to them. And there may be some states, and there probably are, who have a pretty good handle on it, and a pretty good understanding with their hospitals, and who are enforcing that all right. But in general, I think it's somewhat mysterious as to exactly what they're doing. But at least theoretically, I certainly agree with Dr. Commoner that medical waste ought to be handled separately, and if it's incinerated, it ought to be incinerated separately under rules and regulations, which we don't have as an EPA. We don't have any federal rules and regulations. I know that states have some such rules and regulations. And as far as I'm concerned, as far as I know, it should be handled separately. If you have any disagreement on that, or if Washington, D.C. has, please submit that in your written comments on the subject. Well, if there isn't anything further, there's much more that could be said on this very vast subject. But I want to thank the panelists here and the panelists who have testified this morning, as I think considering the time that we have had, that we've gotten down to cases and down to the issues, and the testimony is helpful to me and the others who have been on this panel and will be helpful to our committee and to the members of Congress as we continue to consider these issues, especially with reference to the RCRA legislation, which is before the committee today. If you have any further comments on H.R. 3735, the record will be held open for 30 days for that purposes. We will accept testimony during that time. We will accept Councilwoman Nadine Winter's testimony, which she was working on, as we're advised, and the architect of the Capitol who will be submitting testimony, and anything else that comes in. We thank you very much. If there's nothing further, the subcommittee will be adjourned.
That concludes this hearing of the House Energy and Commerce Subcommittee on Transportation and Hazardous Materials concerning municipal recycling. Please join us later this morning at 10 Eastern Time, 7 on the West Coast, for live coverage of a Senate Judiciary Committee hearing concerning U.S. drug policy in the Andean nations. And coming up next on C-SPAN, it's a discussion of drug testing in the workplace. Good morning from the nation's capital. You're watching C-SPAN. We pause to bring you a schedule update, but first we invite